and have it in the announcements. Also, these little leaflets for children, so their activities, children's activity sheets to do with the Christian Aid service, so you might like to do them during service or afterwards, and a lovely little 7-day devotional that can be used during Christian Aid week or any time at all, just to help you focus on the things, the way we can celebrate and share the good gifts God gives us to share with each other. And as you know, then there's the lunch is on afterwards. And again, it's great to be able to gather together. I think we thought we'd be in a horseshoe, but so many people wanted to come that they've had to rearrange the seating, so you'll be in groups, in your own sort of bubble groups at the tables. But we'll all be together celebrating the good gifts of food that God gives us and then sharing with people around the world through Christian Aid. So I think that's all the announcements. Oh yeah, no, one more. And that is to say, don't forget, you'll see number 4 on the order of service there about the ordination and installation of our new ruling elders, the elders who've been elected and have now been trained. And that is the 29th of May. It's actually 7:30. So if you would plan to come to that, it would be a great boost and a great encouragement for our congregation as well as for the elders themselves. So we turn our thoughts now to our worship this morning. Let us worship God. In the book of Revelation, at the end of the Bible, John paints a picture of the new heaven and the new earth at the end of time when all is complete. In chapter 22, he writes this of the New Jerusalem. On either side of the river is the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. And reflecting on the message of Psalm 1, we remember we're called, come, let us come to the river. Let us be like trees planted by streams of water, putting our roots down deep into God's word, bearing good fruit that will last, not withering from fatigue, but stretching out to receive and to be a source of healing. And let us pray. And if you see on the screen there, if you join in the capital letters in bold print, if you join out loud in those parts. And so we pray. Father God, our Creator, Jesus, Son of God, Holy Spirit of God, we gather together to seek your presence in our time of worship.
We are hungry for you.
Meet us at our point of deepest need. Connect us with the needs of others. Equip us to join in your creative work. Transform us more into your likeness.
We are hungry for your righteousness.
We gather with Janet and Jessica, featured in this Christian Aid week this year, along with their communities in Zimbabwe. May their stories make us hungry for justice and even more impatient for change.
We are hungry for justice.
We gather with your whole creation, mountains and seas, forests, lakes and hills. Like the psalmist, we too shall join with the trees of the field, bursting into song, clapping our hands for joy.
We are hungry to praise you.
And our prayer of confession. Good God of creation, in the warmth of your love, we admit that we have faltered and failed. Even as we raise our voices to sing your praise, we realize that instead of letting you lead us, we have walked on paths that have turned our hearts inwards. We have paid too little heed to the cries of people in poverty. We have ignored those on the margins. We have denied the signs of the earth's distress. And now the axe is poised to cut down the weeds of our greed and our excesses and our uncaring ways that harm your amazing creation. The systems that impoverish all people by enriching a few at the expense of very many, and thus diminish our love and our faith and pull us away from the fullness of life in your love. When our actions and intentions have been as worthless as chaff to be blown away by the winds of heaven. But Lord, because of your gracious mercy, even now it is not too late. Even when the painful results of wrongs we have done and good we have not done stand like an accusation against us, yet you offer us grace and real hope of new life, abundant life, of community in you. And so we pray with real and confident hope. Lord, where we have failed to bear good fruit and to share your abundance for the earth, forgive us, restore us, inspire us now to delight in your purposes, to embrace your possibilities, to inhabit your promises, to flourish as fruit for the world you so love, and bring healing for all the nations.
Amen. Amen.
And so let's sing, "Make me a channel of your peace."
Wonderful to be with you again and to have some visitors from farther afield with us too. I always love it when the global church and a wider world gather to remind us that God is much greater than we know or understand. So let's start with a challenge. I want you to have a quick think, and in 20 seconds, I want you to come up with an animal and a country that start with the same letter as your name. Okay, animal and a country that start with the same letter as your name. I'm Cheryl, and I've got a chimpanzee in Chad. So, anybody got an animal and a country to go with their name? Somebody called something out there, what was it? You've got an ape, and is your name?
Adam.
Adam. Thank you very much, Adam. Adam has got an ape in Africa. That's very good. We could go through the whole alphabet, but I think we might use the whole sermon time. Any more? There's one.
I'm Tracy, a tiger in Tanzania.
So Tracy has a tiger in Tanzania. I love it. Love it. Okay. Well, what would you say if you were given an animal that starts with the letter Z? Zebra, zebra. You see, we've got people from North America here, so we're going to have zebras as well as zebras. Is that okay? We can do diversity. We can do it. And can you think of a country?
Zimbabwe.
Zimbabwe. Okay, because it was mentioned earlier on in the service. Very good. There are other countries that begin with Z, but we'll do Zimbabwe. I don't know how many zebras there are in Zimbabwe, but I do know that any zebras that are living there will be pretty thirsty. Because Zimbabwe, like many other countries across the world, is suffering the effects of climate change, and not in a good way. Put up your hands if you've heard of climate change. Yeah, good. That's good. Okay, so we don't have to explain too much. It's a big issue. God has created an amazing and wonderful world and asked us, human beings, to look after it. But because people haven't, because we've been greedy and selfish and thoughtless, the weather is changing. And the problem for the zebras in Zimbabwe is that there isn't enough water. And it's a problem for people living there too. People like Jessica. This is Jessica. That's her in the middle in the green. It's not so clear on this screen. Jessica lives in Zimbabwe with her family. And like many women in Zimbabwe, Jessica works on a farm. And that's how she gets food to feed her children. But climate change means that the land is too dry to grow things. So Jessica and her children are hungry. But that's not the end of the story, because Christian Aid won't let that be the end of the story. And Christian Aid works with other organizations together to maximize their impact to help change the world for the better. But Christian Aid are going to turn Jessica's hunger into hope. And this Christian Aid week, the money that we raise is going towards providing seeds for women like Jessica, but special seeds, because there's no point in planting any old seeds because they won't grow if there's no rain. These are special seeds that can grow even when there is no rain. And so Jessica will be able to turn her dry and dusty land into a garden of hope with enough for themselves and enough to share. Is that good news? But because we care about the whole of creation, we're not stopping at helping women like Jessica after the damage has already been done. We want to fight climate change itself. We want to protect all the monkeys in Madagascar, all the zebras in Zimbabwe, all the apes in Africa, all the chimpanzees in Chad, tigers in Tanzania, there you go, got there. We want to protect them all. And let's, because it's a big thing, a big challenge, let's talk to the God who gave us this world and who loves this world and ask him for help. Let's pray. Creator God, you have created us and the world because you are love. The world is hurting through climate change. It hurts us and our global neighbors, but it is hurting the poorest people in our world the most. God, change our world, our communities, and us with your love. Perhaps read the rest of this prayer with me. I'll read that second paragraph again. God, change our world, our communities, and us with your love. We want to journey with you to create a better future for everyone. God, to love you is the same as loving your world. To love you is the same as loving our global neighbours. Help us to love others and all of creation so your world can be what you want it to be. Amen.
Kind hands. God's word to us through the scripture, and our reading this morning is from Matthew's Gospel at chapter 5 verses 1 to 12, and this is a part of the Bible that we have been thinking about over the last few months ago, so it's nice to come back to it today. So let's listen for what God has to say to us through the scripture. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Amen. May God bless to us the reading of his word and now the preaching of his word.
What kind of things make you happy? What are the things that really fill you with joy? I'm tempted to make you shout out, but I'm not going to. We'll have the next slide and we'll have a look at some chocolate. Chocolate makes me happy. Anybody else? Yeah, see? Maybe chocolate makes you happy. Maybe if you're a football fan, it's the thought of watching your team win the FA Cup final. Maybe it's time spent with family over a Sunday dinner. Maybe it's the holidays and some peace and quiet, or getting away from it all. What are the things that really give us happiness? Every year there's a report called the World Happiness Report. It ranks 150 countries in order of happiness. And this year, the top country that came top of the happiness ranking was, any guesses? We better have the slide. Anybody know now?
Finland.
It's Finland. For the fifth year in a row. Although I wonder, with what's going on in Ukraine next door, whether that will be the case next year. They base these happiness rankings on factors including relative wealth, life expectancy, freedom, levels of corruption, but also generosity, which includes helping strangers, volunteering, giving donations. In our reading today, we'll move on to the next slide. We heard one of the most well-known portions of Scripture, known as the Beatitudes, from the Latin beatitude something, meaning blessed, blessings. The word translated blessed in Greek, it kind of means how fortunate, how lucky are you? How happy are they? But Jesus isn't just talking about a happy feeling. He's talking about an experience of joy that remains even when the circumstances aren't happy. Because we know the blessing of the living God. The things Jesus identifies as bringing joy are surprising. I mean, if Patricia had stood up and read that reading as a kind of manifesto, how many of you would have voted for her party? Starting with poverty, mourning, ending with persecution. It's not easy stuff. But Jesus has these Beatitudes placed at the beginning of what we call the Sermon on the Mount in the Gospel of Matthew. They're addressed to the disciples, but the rest of the world is listening in. And they're not a list of requirements for getting into heaven. They're a list of the characteristics of the kingdom of God, the reign of God, the kind of place where God is happy. This is what he made us to be like. So those who have been saved by God's grace through death and resurrection of Jesus are called in response not to gather up all the riches for ourselves and be proud and judge other people for disagreeing with us, but to die to ourselves, to rise and to follow Jesus and to live to a different set of standards. And this is what it looks like. This is discipleship. Contrary to the world's idea of living and accruing as much happiness as possible. In these Beatitudes, Jesus turns the world's values completely upside down. And I can't possibly do justice to all of these in the time available, so I'm just going to pick out a few of them, so don't panic. When we get to number two, don't think, goodness me, we're going to be going till until tea time. Firstly, we'll have the first slide. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. But in Luke's version of the sermon, Gospel of Luke, it's even more of a shock. He says, blessed are the poor. And then Luke follows it up with, but woe to you who are rich. Woe to you who are rich. So you're all right if you're poor, but you're going to be in a bad way if you're rich, because you've already received your comfort. That's a kind of shocking thing to hear. Because the worldly wisdom says the rich are the blessed people. They have all the cushions. No harm can come to them that they can't pay their way out of. How wonderful to have money rolling in. How fabulous to be rolling in money. But Jesus says no. Blessed are the poor, and blessed are the poor in spirit. And watch out if you have plenty of money, because the rich are most in danger of losing their souls. We could easily misinterpret this. Jesus is not saying that poverty is a blessing or a good thing or something to aspire to or something that it would be kind for you to inflict on anybody else. But poverty of spirit is about our hearts. It's about where we place our trust and our security, where we invest. Are we generous? Do we hoard up for ourselves? And what do we hoard? We are blessed when our trust and our security is in God alone, and not in wealth, not in houses and pension plans. When we're poor in spirit, we recognize our dependence on God, and we're ready to give up everything to follow Jesus' call, to live in his kingdom, to value the least, the smallest, the most forgotten people. We are set free to be generous with what we have because we hold loosely to the things of this earth. Jesus will say later on in the Sermon on the Mount, store up, hoard up your treasures in heaven rather than on earth. And he doesn't mean we should be doing theology degrees. He means investing in the people that are most precious to the kingdom, the little ones, the forgotten, the poor. This is how disciples live. Christian Aid used to have a slogan on their posters that said, live more simply that others may simply live. Live more simply that others may simply live. And that's really countercultural for us. The pressure is on us to have the next gadget, the next car, the next house, the shiniest bathroom, kitchen, whatever. This countercultural message in this first beatitude is that happiness does not come from those things, but from learning to place our full dependence on God rather than on earthly possessions. What a difference it makes in the world when people have that attitude towards money and possessions. So our next slide. Jesus said, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. This isn't so much talking about those who are grieving for a loved one, although that is also my experience, that the brokenness of mourning is met by amazing consolation in the people who gather round to show love, and also in ways that God opens our eyes through mourning to see the world differently. But Jesus is probably thinking back to Isaiah chapter 61, where the prophet says, God will comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning. Isaiah was talking about people who were mourning the state of Israel at that time. They were longing to see it restored to the promised land that they had hoped for. Jesus is talking about those who mourn the sinful state of the world around them. We mourn the injustice we see in the world, the inequality, the lack of concern for the poor, unjust laws, discrimination, the destruction of the environment, wars, violence. We mourn and long for change. The blessing is for those who are filled with compassion and concern and mourning over the state of the world. Our next slide. In fact, we live in a world where inequality is increasing, where those who have get more and more, and those who don't have become increasingly destitute. According to Oxfam, the world's 10 richest men more than doubled their wealth during the last 2 years of the pandemic. The 10 richest people in the world more than doubled their wealth during the last 2 years of the pandemic. However, in Zimbabwe, more than 500,000 people lost their jobs, and the country as a whole missed out on over $1 billion in tourist revenue from people who would have come to see places like Victoria Falls. And they're dealing with climate change. Jesus' followers reject hoarding the things the world values. Jesus' followers trust in God and share what they have. This is something Christian Aid sees all the time in the communities that we work with. We're focusing on the impact of the climate crisis on people in the northeast of Zimbabwe, where they face recurrent drought because of climate change and lower rainfall and longer dry spells. And these people are the ones who have done the least to contribute to global warming and climate change. Our next slide. These droughts affect people's ability to grow enough food to feed their families. This is Janet Zurugo. And we'll pause for a moment here to watch a video about her. I'll keep talking till it starts. Janet's 70 years old. You'll get some of this again in the video. She's a great grandmother. She has 10 children, 28 grandchildren, and 4 great grandchildren. Did I say she had 28 great grandchildren? 28 grandchildren, 4 great grandchildren. And she's responsible for them all. But the place where she lives has had low rainfall, and it's getting worse because of climate change. She says that they used to plough in October, but now they have to wait until November or December to plough, so that shortens their growing season. And so Christian Aid is supporting a large project in this region, bringing together 4 of our partner organisations. They're teaching people new ways of farming that help them make the most of the water that they have. Is the video going to come? Because if it's not, we can just skip on. There we go. Let's do that, and then we'll come back. Ha. Let's skip the video. It's fine. I've got other slides and pictures. We'll do it again. Is that okay, Trish? We skip the video. All right. So if we just move on to the next slide, then you can see. You can go online. You can go to the website, Christian Aid website, and you can see the video for yourselves. Okay. So feel free to do that. Christian-aid.org. Can't remember. Panic. It'll be on the leaflets you have somewhere. So they're teaching people new ways of farming that help them make the most of the water they have, with conservation farming techniques that will help the environment and also help them to irrigate their land. Can we just move on to the slides? Is that okay? Skip, or are we stuck? I love technology. You see, before you had technology, you just had to get on with it, and you lot just had to sit there and listen while ministers talked for hours. Oh, there we go. Right. So we'll skip forward to, that's Janet. Go forward one. And we'll see her with her grandson, hopefully. Oh, no, that's her home. Pretty poor. Yes, there we go. And that's improving. That's with her grandson. Keep going forward, another one. So there they are doing the project to improve the irrigation and the agricultural methods to protect from loss of water and to keep the moisture in. Okay, we'll flick forward one more. There she is, actually having water to pour on the plants. Isn't that exciting? Things we take for granted in this country where we have so much. Okay, we'll flick forward another one. That's our wee grandchildren, and they're training them to look after small livestock like goats and chickens so that they can use the waste products that they have and manage with scrub, because goats are great for eating things that humans can't eat. So that's all very good. Okay, flick forward one more. We see the way the... Is it flicking forward? No. Conservation farming has helped Janet enormously. And there's a picture coming up, hopefully, of her with a variety of grains. And she remembers a time when she had so little to go around that she would share out her food, and she still kept a little portion for the dog, and she put it on the floor, and she nipped out of the room, and when she came back in, the children were eating the dog's food, and she realised how bad it was. There wasn't enough for them all. But now, as a result of the support that she's had from Christian Aid, she says that if her whole family were to visit, she could feed them. As well as helping people to adapt their farming to climate change, just ignore the pictures, that's not it. We're also, and you, as you contribute to Christian Aid, are giving people in Zimbabwe alternative ways of making a living. So we have another picture of a woman called Jirina, farther on, and she is a vendor of fruit and veg that she sells to passing traffic. But during the pandemic, it became really hard to get the food, to sell the food. And so Christian Aid were able to step in and give her alternative training in welding, of all things. I'd love to learn how to weld. And she can make window frames and farming tools and all sorts of things. And that's become an alternative source of income for her. She can go to market, she can sell the food, but in times of drought, she has this alternative in welding. And she's even learning now to use the welding to make tools that are helping her in growing the food. We're getting there. There she is. Yeah, go forward, another one. That's Jirina. Is she stuck again? There we go. So we're trying to give people a range of skills that can empower them to make the best of the circumstances that have been inflicted upon them by climate change that has come from elsewhere. We're helping to support people to adapt to the climate crisis. But as Jesus followers, we mourn still for the way the world is, for those who face the worst impacts of the climate crisis. And we mourn for those who are suffering from climate crisis, but also from war. And Christian Aid has also been involved. There's another slide we can come to of lots of people gathered on a platform, a train platform. We wanted to say thank you to everybody who has contributed to Christian Aid's appeal or in other ways to support the 10 million people who've been forced to leave their homes because of the war in Ukraine. Christian Aid's been working through Hungarian Church Aid to provide shelter for people in Western Ukraine and to provide food and water and hygiene kits to people at the border. Let's move on to our next beatitude. The fourth beatitude says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness." This is often thought of as just referring to our own righteousness, our desire to do God's will, which is a nice thing, and to be good people. It's important, but it's not the only meaning, because we know that we will never achieve our own righteousness, no matter how hard we hunger and thirst. Excuse me. It's been a long time since I sneezed in a pulpit. There we go. But this beatitude is also about those who hunger and thirst for God's righteousness. The word righteousness, we've got two words in English, but the Greek word is justice and righteousness. So you're hungering and thirsting for justice as much as for personal righteousness. I like to think of it in terms of right relationships. Justice is about right relationships, and righteousness is about right relationships. So hungering and thirst for God's righteousness, for God's will to be done on earth as in heaven. Hungering and thirsting and praying for God to set things right. So Christian Aid, as well as working in practical ways to support people like Janet and Jirina, is also trying to work with those who create policies and laws, the things that actually cause people to become poor and to get stuck in poverty. So Christian Aid speaks out for justice in the world. Hunger and thirst for justice. There she is. It's probably too late for that, for Janet now. We'll have to just keep going. Lastly, Jesus talks of those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Jesus knows that those who live according to his standards, people who challenge the accumulation of great wealth, are going to come up against great powers that are going to use those powers to keep their wealth. So there's danger in challenging the injustices of the world. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a man, a German theologian, who lived during the rise of the Nazi Party in the 1930s. And he was so inspired by Jesus' teachings and the Sermon on the Mount that he was led to speak out against the injustice of Hitler's actions against the Jewish people and others. And he organized resistance amongst his fellow Germans to try and stop Hitler's obscenities. And he did it at great personal cost. He ended up being arrested and was eventually killed for his stand. But he knew that the call of Jesus is to live a different way of life. And this includes standing up for justice in the world, even when it inevitably leads to persecution. And so he wrote this: "We're not to simply bandage the wounds of victims beneath the wheels of injustice. We are to drive a spoke into the wheel itself." At Christian Aid, we don't just want to bandage the wounds of victims. But as Bonhoeffer said, we want to drive a spoke into the wheel of injustice. We want to change the systems and the structures that keep people poor, because as Christian Aid, it is our faith in Christ, our faith in the God of the Bible, who calls us to live this alternative kingdom. So as we look back to all that Jesus did for us that we celebrate at Easter, his life being taken as a sacrifice in the face of great injustice, our response to his gift of grace is to follow him, to live a different way, a truly blessed life, to die to ourselves, to die to our own comfort, to be willing to take the risk of standing against injustice, to hunger for those who are hungry, hunger for God to set things right, to strive for peace and to become peacemakers, to stand up for God's ways in the world. Because Jesus teaches us that the least and the poorest and the forgotten are the greatest in the kingdom. This is where we find the joy and the blessing of his kingdom. And he promises to make us a people who are set on a hill. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Do we want to be part of his family, his kingdom, bring his justice, his peace, bring hope and life to people who are just broken because the powers that wage against them are so great? Individually, it's too great for any of us. But I do believe that together, by supporting an organization like Christian Aid, because Christian Aid is also willing to work together with other organizations, we can have our voices heard, have laws changed, and have justice stood for and sometimes achieved in our world. As a foretaste of all that God has promised to give us, that Trish read about with the river of life and the trees that give their fruit in season at the very beginning of the service. It's beautifully brought together. So thank you all for listening, and be blessed and be a blessing in this world through the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, thank you very much, Cheryl. Just giving us that wider picture of what we're celebrating in the world and what we're sharing. And you know what they say, sometimes the best pictures are on the radio. So, you know, I'm sure you had wonderful pictures in your mind for our glitches there. And well done, the team, keeping going anyway. So now let's pray. And if you join in again on the... Oh, they're all big and bold. But anyway, the ones that are in capital letters in bold. So let us pray. Creator God, cultivator of our faith, thank you for the privilege of living in this global garden, planted to bear your fruit, to delight our taste, to fill our bellies, to energize our bodies. You have given us life in all its fullness. You have given us life, and yet millions still hunger. We pray for Zimbabwe, Afghanistan, Syria, Ukraine, and all other places of suffering. Keep our hearts gentle to feel for them and to respond as we can with care for their needs. Take our gifts of money and use them to help Christian Aid support communities throughout the world and partners who hunger to provide. But may our support not end there. May we be the seeds from which your kingdom grows. And together we say, God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. We also pray for our families and our local community. We pray for those who are ill, be that in body or mind or spirit. For those who are grieving because they are sad. For those who are mourning because they want a better world. For those who have their worries. For those who have prepared for their exams, and we pray that they would let their brilliance shine as they do their exam papers. For those who are full of the joys now as they look forward to a new chapter in life, through marriage, through the arrival of a new baby, through all kinds of good events in their lives. And in a moment of quiet now, we pray for whatever God puts on our hearts. Lord, hear these and all our prayers. Keep us living your way all our days here on earth, and then gather us with all your people into your immediate presence, where all is complete, eternally. We ask these things in Jesus' name, and as he taught us, so we pray aloud together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so we stand to sing, Fold to Your Heart.
Thank you.
thank you, Lord, for the blessing of food to eat and food to share. Bless the hands that prepared the meal, and bless us as we enjoy eating together, whether here or in our own homes, and as we share with others through the work of Christian Aid. And now may the grace of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you forever and ever. Amen.